Morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Wake up. Okay. Is this on? Can you hear me okay in the back? Yeah, good. So, welcome on this early Saturday morning to our session on promoting integrated primary care through interprofessional education. I'm Susan McDaniel, and I have the pleasure of chairing this session this morning. Last year, when I had the honor of serving as president of the American Psychological Association, my plan was to focus on healthcare and do as much as I could to advance the science of psychology and the practice of psychologists as part of healthcare reform. While my attention was distracted just a tad during that time by the independent review, I'm pleased I was able to accomplish virtually all the goals I set during my president-elect year. And I wanted to just tell you about that. So we had a meeting of all the leaders of the primary care associations at APA to discuss how we can advance integrated primary care through interprofessional education, exchange about research and advocacy, which occurred in April of 2016. We had a focus on integrated specialty care, which about the innovations occurring in these diverse contexts and the opportunities for psychologists to establish research, education, and clinical programs in specialty health care. And this group hopes to publish two papers, one for a medical audience and one for a psychology audience. So I'll put a green check, which means it's still in process. The application of what we know about the science of teamwork to healthcare. I'm currently co-editing a special issue of the American Psychologist with team researcher extraordinaire Eduardo Salas. We reviewed many proposals for this special edition and gave the green light to write papers on 31 of them. So we're at the end of the first round of reviews about papers on team science of all kinds, teams in space, restaurants, schools, corporate America, disaster relief, healthcare, you name it. And we expect that special issue to be out sometime mid-2018. We also gave on Thursday recognition of the importance of interprofessional research teams with psychologists on them. So to that end, with the Board of Scientific Affairs, I gave the first APA prize for interdisciplinary team research to a team from University of Miami who work at the Center for Research and Education on Aging and Technology Enhancement, or CREATE. And this group is a great example of the interdisciplinary team who can bring diverse expertise to the rewards and challenges of technology adaptation in older adults. And finally, the group that you're going to hear about today. I spent my career in an academic health center at University of Rochester teaching health and mental health to a variety of health professionals. And I've been concerned for about the last 10 years that many professionals were beginning to have these interprofessional seminars together. Some were funded by SAMHSA. And really recognizing that the importance of learning together early in order to work well as teams later, whether we're talking about research or practice. And I noticed that psychology wasn't included in the vast majority of these projects, nor was I hearing anyone in psychology complain about that. So while we know that psychologists teach in the full range of health professional education, how many psychologists are taught by anyone other than psychologists prior to applying one's skills in training or research? So I don't think this is in our best interest. When medical, nursing, and social work students come together, they find out what each other's good for. They become comfortable with each other. They learn how each other thinks, and they just plain learn from each other. So I really thought, we need to be a part of this. Integrated primary care offers a wonderful opportunity for a seminar early in our graduate education. There are many foundational topics for integrated primary care that all involve disciplines need to learn, and it's not discipline-specific learning. In fact, they can be more efficiently and effectively taught together. Topics such as population health, quality improvement, leadership skills, collaborative care, ethics, the nature of primary care, and how that affects its processes, the science of teamwork as applied to primary care, etc. So while it's rare to have psychology faculty teaching or students participating in interprofessional seminars early in psychology education, we have here a handful of pioneers, mavericks, innovators, etc. They're sitting in front of you today. So here we brought them together to put together a curriculum for an interprofessional seminar on integrated primary care, and boy did they. I attended their meeting. It was really so much fun, and it's been really interesting to see how this came together. So I'm so pleased to share with you this work today. I want to thank all of them for their great work, and a special thanks to co-chairs Ron Rozensky and Jeff Goodie, with the talented support of Kathy Grus, the Associate Director of the Education Directorate at APA. So each person's going to have a brief 8 minutes to tell you about some part of the curriculum. Because a few of our members aren't here today, there's some people, I think particularly Dr. Goodie, who's going to do double time. I'll keep careful track of time and perhaps make some brief comments at the end, and then we'll have time for your comments and questions. So I believe we're starting with Dr. Grus.
All right, well, good morning. It's quite an honor to be called a pioneer, an innovator, or a maverick at 8 a.m. on a Saturday morning during convention. You just gave me a jolt of energy that caffeine couldn't do for me. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity this morning to give you just a short overview of kind of conceptual basis for this interprofessional curriculum. But I did want to take a quick minute and acknowledge a few individuals and organizations that were really instrumental in the creation of this interprofessional seminar. As Susan mentioned, a couple members of our group unfortunately were not able to be here today, so I'd like to acknowledge them. Ben Miller, Kaylee Ross, who is Ben's student, and Ann Stewart, and they very much regretted that they weren't able to be part of this team. We developed a very close working relationship over the course of this project, and really everybody wanted to be here, and so sorry they couldn't be here. Also would like to acknowledge a few organizations, the American Board of Professional Psychology, APA Division 43, which is Family Psychology, and APA Division 56, which is Trauma Psychology. Each of these organizations contributed financially to this project to ensure that we could get together for a face-to-face meeting to make this all get pulled together. So thank you very much to those organizations. And finally, I'd like to thank a group of individuals who volunteered their time to go through what is a 200-plus page document and give us comments and feedback about it before we had a final product. These were very important individuals because they represented disciplines outside of psychology, and we thought it was very important to have that lens on our document to make sure that we weren't being too psychology-centric, because as Susan mentioned, our goal was really to have a curriculum that would be applicable to students from a variety of healthcare disciplines. So I want to just talk a couple minutes with you about the context for why we think this is a really important product to put forward at this particular time. To start that, I think it's really important to understand what we mean when we say interprofessional. I like to go with a definition that's been put out by the World Health Organization. I think it's succinct and really captures what it is that we're trying to accomplish when we talk about interprofessional education. And specifically, what we mean is when students from two or more professions learn about, from and with each other to enable effective collaboration and improve healthcare outcomes. And it's that learning with, about, and from each other that I think is a real key piece that we haven't seen when we talk about things like multidisciplinary practice or even interdisciplinary practice. As Susan alluded to in her remarks, it's much more the case that our psychology trainees receive a lot of their education, if not all of their education, from psychologists. This has certainly been the model we've been using since the 1940s. It's a good model. But what that promotes, though, is the opportunity for stereotypes to be developed because we're not exposing our students to other healthcare disciplines. It also certainly promotes silos where people are trained within their profession and don't have the opportunity to learn about how other professions are being trained. Certainly does not foster the competencies that we know are needed if our students are going to be out in team-based care settings. Also like to mention that we came about with the framework of interprofessional collaborative practices not being something that we just discovered a couple years ago. Really, this concept has been promoted for decades. If you go back and look at the literature, certainly it has expanded as expanded access to healthcare has increased in this country recently. But this is a construct that people have been talking about for many, many years. It really got steam back in the early 2000s when people were talking about patient safety, patients wanting quality care. And people started thinking about the best ways to deliver health care, and team-based care is certainly ideal for that. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Dr. Rozensky, who's going to give you some details about the seminar.
Thank you, Kathy. And thank you, everybody on the panel. This has been quite a fun group to work with, and when you come up with a product as awesome as this, when it's fun, it's really a great adventure. The web address you see there, you can go on the APA website and you can take a brief survey about your knowledge of interprofessional and interest in interprofessional education and training, and then download our 200 and some pages of curriculum for your use at home. So it's there, it's ready to be used. What we did not do is provide you with a complete, here it is, PowerPoint, do it yourself, use our stuff. What we provided for you is a group of modules to help you at the local level structure your curriculum so it works for you and your interprofessional organization. So what I'd like to do is just give you some of the highlights of our goals that describe what we've done. This was really designed as a best practice competency-based model for preparing learners from psychology and other disciplines. And we use the term learners because it can be applied across the spectrum of when students are in the classroom. And this is really a classroom-based seminar that's designed to probably be prior to students entering the clinic so that they're getting some of the basic knowledge competencies, preparing them to go into the clinical setting to work interprofessionally. We provide steps to build a successful seminar, including solutions to inevitable challenges, and you'll hear about those towards the end of our talk today. It's, like I said, intended to be a classroom-based course co-taught with other disciplines. And we do give some recommendations and ideas of how to engage your other colleagues from other disciplines, medicine, nursing, PT, OT, pharmacy, so that you can work together as a team to then build the seminar so that all students can be in the classroom together from all the disciplines. So you see from the very beginning of this educational process that Kathy referred to, they're learning together so that when they move into the clinic or the hospital unit, they're prepared to work together clinically. It's designed to have 8 content modules, and I'll show those to you in a minute or two. that are customizable for your local situation. You can rearrange, move the modules in order, or leave modules out, and of course add modules, but we'll show you those. It's important to develop interprofessional competencies need to be successful individual members of the healthcare team. So not only are we expecting our students to be quality, well-prepared, competent psychologists, but how do you then be a competent, quality member of a team? And that's a competency unto itself. And same thing for the other disciplines. How do they work together in a team? And this is what we're doing in the seminar, is teaching that. It includes learning outcomes and classroom lecture material, activities, and resources within each one of the modules. So we don't write the lectures, we provide materials for you then to use to structure it yourself. And it infuses discussion and mastery of concepts of diversity, individual societal differences, and differences across disciplines as well, which is another type of diversity that must be dealt with within the team setting. And lastly, the goal of the seminar is to take the competencies acquired in the classroom and make sure that students, learners are ready to use those when they're on the floor or the clinic. So these are, excuse me, these are the modules that were prepared, and names there are the lead person who prepared those modules. And what you're going to hear now in that order is about 8 minutes from each one of us describing our module, our learning objectives, and some of the resources that we have available online. We can't highlight them all, but if you download it, you'll get those modules with more information on the educational objectives, or learning objectives, and the resources. But that's the order from that we're going to now move into, and I will turn this over to Dr. Goodie, who's going to start with rationale.
Well, good morning, everyone. So I'm kind of curious, just looking out into the audience. First of all, you guys are amazing to be here this early in the morning, so thank you. How many of you work in primary care settings? Okay, wow, quite a few of you. Fantastic. And how many of you work with other professionals within? Okay, perfect. So all of you have already downloaded this curriculum then. That's fantastic. I think that, you know, part of this curriculum, part of where we wanted to start is really kind of talking about, well, why is it important for behavioral health in particular, and psychologists specifically, to work in primary care settings? Before we kind of get into kind of some of the other modules, we wanted to kind of give that kind of big picture approach to what is different about working in primary care, particularly if you have never done that before. Now, so many of you in this room, it sounds like, have had those experiences in primary care, and you know what a culture shock that can be from traditional kind of mental health practice. But we do, you know, there's still many out there who I think need, who it's important to kind of talk about kind of, you know, why it's important for us to be in primary care, for us to integrate behavioral health into primary care broadly across many different professions, not just psychology. We give an overview of how this integration has been accomplished, and I suspect, given kind of all the hands that went up in here, I'm sure I could speak, you know, each one of you probably has a slightly different model from the other in terms of what's been working in your system. And certainly in this, in what we developed, we don't cover the, you know, every single way that folks have done this successfully, but we do touch on some of the different models and really kind of the full spectrum of ways in which folks have been able to integrate behavioral health into primary care. And then we talk about some of those interprofessional issues to consider. And so as we go kind of through that module, you know, so one where we kind of start out is really trying to differentiate between traditional mental health and behavioral health that might be provided within the primary care context. And so for many folks, you know, who have integrated into primary care, there's, you know, this shift from things like, you know, a 50-minute hour that typically doesn't work well in a primary care setting. And so, you know, talking about how you might do different forms of consultation, how you might see patients in different ways, what that spectrum looks like, that's part of what we talk about in here. And also really talk about sort of that rationale then of why it's so important, and I'm preaching to the choir in this room, but you know, the whole idea that so much of this country's mental health is actually provided, mental health care is actually provided within the primary care context, you know, helping folks to kind of recognize that and understand that is a place where we need to be as psychologists, but by putting ourselves there, we're going to undergo some culture shock, and that's really what this whole curriculum in part is about. We emphasize the ideas of step care. Again, many folks have been exposed to that, but it becomes particularly important in primary care settings. Not everything can be handled in primary care, and I don't think you'd find many primary care providers who would say everything is handled in primary care. But for many folks, you know, that's where they start. And so having that breadth, having that ability to see almost anything that might be coming through the door is a really important skill. And in many psychology programs, that's not necessarily the emphasis. The emphasis isn't necessarily about that breadth of training. But that's absolutely critical for working in primary care. So the idea that you may see a lot of things, you may not be able to treat all of it in primary care, and to understand kind of what step care is and how you might move from being in primary care to a more intensive specialty care. And then, as I mentioned already, kind of these ideas of this continuum of ways to integrate considerations for effective team building. Primary care really works on the idea of a team. There is no single person who is responsible for, you know, a patient's care. And we'll hear a little bit more about sort of the ideas of population health, but certainly population health is critical in a primary care context and seeing patients there. And so we talk about some of the things. We touch a little bit on ideas of team science, what that looks like, what are some of the ways that we know that individuals can work together kind of most effectively in order to be really just effective in their primary care group or team. And then we provide a bunch of resources, and unlike this talk, which is mostly us talking at you, the idea of the whole seminar is that we've tried to inject activities and things where this is not necessarily a particularly good way for folks to learn about interprofessional teamwork. And so, you know, we tried to develop some ways within each module for folks to interact. And so these resources, you know, here, some of these are readings. Some of the things that you, when you download the curriculum, which you're all doing right now, you will, there are videos in there. I know, like for this one, you know, I sort of had the lead on creating this module. You know, there's a video in there that I say, you know, you might want to watch this before you show it to your class. So you should always review kind of what we put out there, because it's intended for you to adapt it to your environment and to your learners. But things like videos, having folks watch that and then having them discuss the content of that is far more enriching. And you learn far more than having kind of these talks. I also want to talk, I just mentioned briefly that Division 38 has a fabulous integrated primary care series of modules that really talk about how to do this. And if you haven't seen all their work, 14, 15, I forget how many modules, and some of the authors of that are in this room. But that really is a fantastic resource, and we reference it in this module for folks to go to if they really want to understand, you know, how you can actually, from a nuts and bolts perspective, do that. So I will end there, but you'll see me again, so don't worry. Thank you.
We're like the pop-up puppets here, but Jeff's going to steal the show here today with helping us with our talk. I had the privilege of working on the population health module in the curriculum, and I would point my colleague out down here, Dr. Bruce Rybarczyk, who was a big help with this particular module. I think, again, given the number of you that are familiar with delivering services in the primary care setting, population health is probably a construct that you're familiar with, but for a lot of psychologists, it's very different than the way we typically think about delivering healthcare services. So this was a really critical module to have as part of the curriculum. So just real quickly, again, I think I'm explaining this to people who know it far better than I do, but a population health approach is very different because we're looking at the idea of health of groups of people versus focusing on the individual. So the outcomes are to really improve the health of large numbers of peoples and promote small changes in large numbers of people versus a big change in small numbers of people. Within this module, we focus on several constructs that are instrumental to the idea of what population health is. Certainly, foremost to this is the social determinants of health and health disparities, something that I think psychologists are well prepared to talk about, but applications of that as it relates to physical and mental health. We also discuss healthcare policy and how, in some cases, it can promote a population-based approach to care, and other cases it might hinder. And we reference certain types of policy legislation in the modules to help people have those discussion. We talk about implementing a population health approach in the primary care setting, how that might work, what are some models for doing this type of approach. We draw a connection specifically between population health and behavioral health. Again, while this is an interprofessional curriculum, we really want to highlight the contributions that behavioral health and psychological science do make to healthcare delivery and promotion of good healthcare outcomes. And finally, we talk about community-oriented primary care and the roles that we can have in that type of service delivery model. I think you're going to hear some repetition in our key resources as we go through the modules, because there are just really some real go-to places that really encompass a lot of great resources. And Jeff, I think, described them very well. These are often video-based resources, case vignettes, all kinds of things that are really amenable for discussion-based learning in the classroom. The Institute for Healthcare Improvement has a number of training modules. You're going to hear about a few more of those when we get to the quality improvement section, but they do have a couple that are very relevant to population health, one here on improving health equity, and then introduction to triple aim for populations. There's another curriculum that I have mentioned up here that's specific to population health. This is a very detailed curriculum, has a lot of great learning examples, as well as it's structured around a competency framework, certainly very useful. Many of you are probably familiar with the core competencies for interprofessional collaborative practice that first came out in 2011. They were updated in 2016, and one of the major facets of that update was to infuse a population health perspective on those competencies. So I think those are particularly important for this module. And again, I'll just give a shout out to the Division 38 Integrated Care Curriculum. We have Dr. Barbara Ward-Zimmerman here, who is one of the leads on that, Dr. Mark Vogel, Dr. Nancy Ruddy. It just was a spectacular piece of work that they put together, and a really nice complement to what we've done in our particular group. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Goodie again. Thank you.
Did you miss me? All right. just in case you're wondering, I'm not with the hotel staff. This uniform is with the U.S. Public Health Service, of which I am a captain of the U.S. Public Health Service, and one of the seven uniform services. And if you didn't know there were seven uniform services, if you get really bored while I'm talking, you can look up what all seven are. So I started out my last little module asking you all about how many of you had worked in primary care. How many of you are ethical? Just I'm wondering, okay. Wow, a lot fewer hands went up. We are in DC, I guess. I guess you'll fit right in. So anyhow, of course, I should not be saying that in uniform. Okay, anyhow. And video recorded. Great. So anyhow, they'll be waiting for me outside. Anyhow, so with our ethics module, I think, and this was really led by Ann Stewart, who sadly couldn't be here today, but Ann just brought really so much knowledge and background, and she's really kind of been teaching a lot about interprofessionalism for many years, and we leaned on her heavily, and she had taken on the ethics module, and as you can see here, this ethics module is, as we mentioned, it uses learning experiences, readings, and resources to look at, the dilemmas that folks experience within primary care practice. And some of the things that come up are, talking about, the different professions, ethics codes, what those are, what are the similarities, and what are the differences? How are decisions made differently? And what are some of the ethical issues that folks need to kind of consider when they're taking on kind of their different professional roles? And Anne does a really good job, and the team that created this, of doing some case-based examples, so giving some cases and then giving some questions that kind of prompt conversation and discussion within the context of the class. In here, we talk about sort of, this interprofessional collaboration domain and communication competencies and research findings associated with that, comparing the codes of ethics of health professions, as I mentioned, and then the roles of psychologists and health professionals related to ethical concerns. And this includes both ethical concerns that may come up in the context of cultural differences or even in the use of technology. With Anne, you'll see as we look at some of the key resources here, and these are just really some of them. As you guys can see on the curriculum that you've already downloaded, that there are exercises here. She's pulled some from Med Portal, for instance, that she was involved in making TED Talks, and websites for folks to kind of use. I think that as many of you probably know, or maybe you don't, given your ethics. But there's lots of ethical dilemmas that come up in the context of primary care, and you, as a presumably as a psychologist, are going to have one way that you believe that this needs to be handled. But somebody from nursing, a physician, a social work, whoever you might be working with, may really see this very differently, and may be working well within their means of. Well within the realm of their ethical code, and recognizing that and being able to have a discussion about that and really working together as a team to be able to navigate those situations, ultimately to provide the best care for patients, because at the end of the day, that's what this is really all about. This is about how do you work as a team to be able to provide the best care for patients. But you've got to be aware of your blind spots. And that's the thing, as we were kind of talking about, so often we are training psychologists, you know, within our silo of psychology. And for me, I'm relatively fortunate that we have a psychology program within a school of medicine, which makes it a lot easier for our students to have these interactions with physicians and nurses. And we get our students, for instance, involved in providing feedback to some of our nursing students as they're learning to do clinical interviews. And in the context of those conversations, you know, the ideas of ethics can easily kind of come up. But this module, you know, the idea of being able to bring kind of different professions together in a room and being able to have folks really kind of talk about these different things really can help to really shine a spotlight on similarities and differences. And with so many of you in the room working in primary care, I think you can tap into those resources to have those kinds of conversations. So I will go ahead. So next up, talking about models of leadership, I'd like to introduce Jeff Goodie, coming back up to the stage. I did not write all of these, just so you all know. This is I'm getting the easy lift here by coming up here and talking about these things. This was led by Brian, and he really did a lot of work in terms of developing this the models of leadership module that you guys will see. I'm kind of curious. So how many of you are leaders, first of all? Any of you leaders? Yeah, okay, a couple up here. All right. But a more serious question, how many of you actually had any classes on leadership within your training? One, two, three, a few folks, okay. So, you know, I think that this is a really interesting opportunity in order to, you know, to be able to take, again, this curriculum, and I can't stress enough, I don't think any of us can stress enough, that this is designed for you to take it and make it your own. You do not have, you know, this is not, one module isn't dependent on the other module. I mean, we purposely, purposely designed it that way. But, you know, if you just wanted the leadership module, you could take that out and you could apply it kind of to yourself to your program or to the folks that you're training. I'm particularly talking about leadership within the context of primary care and within the context of interprofessionalism. When we think about sort of models of leadership, you know, there is a huge industry, really, about leadership, and so we try in the module to really kind of narrow down some of the conversation, and again provide some opportunities to talk about different types of leaderships and the ways in which people might serve as leaders. So, so we review kind of the contemporary models of leadership. Actually, one of the books that's recommended as part of this, actually part of what that does is just go through each type of leadership model, kind of, and talks about the strengths and the weaknesses of each model, the ways in which that model that there might be some research behind it. So it's an awfully long book for you to incorporate into just, if you were doing one class or something like that. But if you were doing an entire semester, the book would be actually potentially useful. But you can pick out a few of the leadership models that you want to bring in. Maybe you could talk about, you know, two different styles of leadership, compare and contrast them. But again, there are, you know, kind of established leadership models out there that you can bring in and talk about, and talk about how that plays into interprofessional healthcare teams, particularly within primary care settings. Talking about kind of typical structures and functions of leaders, as I mentioned, some of the assumptions behind the models and considerations for the implementation. And the use of technology and leadership. And so the module is really kind of set up to, you know, again, kind of focus on these conceptualizations. We talk about leadership competencies and what it takes to be sort of a successful leader. and then talk about cultural awareness and technology and leadership. And this piece about cultural awareness and technology is something that we've incorporated into really each of the modules as a way, because again, technology is changing very rapidly. You know, the need to be kind of culturally aware really changes, you know, potentially with every single patient. You know, it is critical to pay attention to those things regardless of what the topic is. And again, you know, we go through and talk about, you know, again, a variety of resources related to leadership. And, you know, it can be, you know, for behavioral health professionals going into primary care, you know, you can think sometimes that, well, the leaders are the physicians, the leaders are the nurses. I can't be a leader within primary care. And I think that as many of you in this room, you know, are in primary care settings, or if you're not there, and if you're thinking about going there, there are lots of opportunities for behavioral health providers to serve as leaders within the context of primary care. And I think that taking the time to reflect on what those leadership attributes need to be, what they should be, particularly in the context of primary care, particularly within the context of interprofessional collaborations, you know, is going to be critical for, if not for yourself, for the students that we're training, you know, down the line. And having different professionals in the room, again, having psychologists with social workers, with physicians, with nurses, to talk about how they view leadership, how they see themselves as leaders, and what they bring to the team within primary care, I think is really key. And again, as you can see here, you know, we talk about different case studies associated with leadership, and give folks something that a common case for folks to kind of discuss and talk about how they might handle those situations differently. Again, you know, if you go on to TED Talk, TED's got a lot of great talks specifically on leadership. There's this one by Stanley McChrystal, but there's also some other talks on there, hour-long talks that really just focus on this whole idea of leadership. One has, I know, Sheryl Sandberg on there. And I think that it provides really a rich place to start, you know, for everybody to have kind of that common core where they're starting, and then they can talk about kind of, although it may not be specific to leadership within the healthcare setting, talking about how one leads, how one also follows, and as part of being a leader, is really key, particularly in the context of primary care. So, I am not Lisa, so I'm going to sit down and let her talk, let somebody else talk. Thank you all very much, and you'll see me again, don't worry.
So, many of you are working in care settings with other professionals. How many of you have been hearing about quality improvement or are participating on quality improvement teams? And ultimately, one of the big picture ideas here is improving the quality of health care and health outcomes is an interprofessional process. It is a team-based activity that requires the expertise and coordination of everyone, all of us in healthcare, to get to the improvement outcomes that we're looking for. So when we think about quality improvement, or QI, QI is the method, and it's a method that's been demonstrated as effective in yielding improvements in complex systems. And healthcare is a complex system. And so really what QI is all about is this idea of using a systems-minded approach that is very systematic and data-driven. And in order for healthcare to improve, all of us need to have competencies in this area, which is really kind of what is the crux of kind of having this foundational model that's an interprofessional context for learners to get together to learn foundational skills, knowledge, and a mindset that's necessary to improve healthcare. And so some of the key objectives or the key learning outcomes from this module that the interprofessional learners have the opportunity to learn about, first is why we need to improve. This is a real opportunity to kind of develop that kind of shared understanding across professionals and get different perspectives about why the healthcare system isn't meeting the needs and expected outcomes, and being able to come together and have a shared understanding of that is really foundational. And ultimately, one of the key purposes that I hope this module does for learners is really to kind of set the stage that improvement is something that we all need to commit to, that it is our interprofessional responsibility and is its own competency area. And so the module really kind of emphasizes that concept as well. And ultimately as well, what the module is really about is developing those foundational skills, that foundational knowledge, the foundational tools that are necessary to implement improvements. And doing so within an interprofessional learning group really allows for there to be activities, discussions, where we get different perspectives about what's needed in healthcare, how does improvement happen, how do teams work together, and really getting an understanding of what different individuals bring to improvement teams and improvement efforts. So to talk just a little bit more about kind of the module and its content, really the module really begins with talking about why we need to improve, and kind of giving that foundational knowledge about what are the challenges, what are the barriers to quality care in our healthcare system. It relies a good deal on the Institute of Medicine's seminal reports on the safety and quality of healthcare in the United States, to ERA's Human and the Quality Chasm Report. And it's really an opportunity for learners to understand and appreciate the depth of challenges that we have in healthcare. And then when we turn to what needs to be improved and the quality aims, kind of again coming from the Institute of Medicine, it really allows for that opportunity for them to understand that many of the things that need to be improved are not improved by individual providers or siloed teams, but were really improved in healthcare teams. The necessary needs for coordination of care, how important that is for efficiency, all of those kinds of things. It's a real opportunity for teams to come together early on and be able to identify what each discipline, what each profession is bringing to that context. And to develop that passion and mission. And in terms of the how to improve, the module relies on the model for improvement, and that's a model that is oftentimes used in clinical settings. So we see a lot of our colleagues in nursing and medicine relying on the model for improvement. That's actually the name of it, as a method to learn about QI methodology. And in a second, I'll talk about IHI, but that's also the IHI modules are also leaning very heavily on that model. And that model really talks about fundamental questions that you need to ask, and then iterative processes about understanding if your change is yielding an improvement. And within the module, there's a real opportunity for the learners to get together and to be able to kind of work through some of the steps that are part of the model for improvement, to be able to then really identify and see kind of firsthand how it is a team-based approach and different perspectives are really important for improvement. And I think ultimately the goal within that was really to try and weave into the module this idea that healthcare is a complex system and that it requires kind of that team-based approach in order to yield outcomes. And obviously, if you get together in this way, you have the opportunity to be able to share. Key resources that I want to point out. Berwick's report is just a great overview. The IHI Open School modules, just so that you know, in the module itself, I specify the different kinds of categories that are really most helpful. There are 101 modules on QI. But if you are a faculty member or a student, those modules are free to you. You just have to register as either a faculty member or a student. And the IHI has hot off the press an essentials toolkit. And the last thing is a fundamental book on the model for improvement. Thank you.
Did you miss me? All right. This is the last time. Often we, I'm guessing you guys clap for Liza because it was not me. So I'm curious, start out with another question. So a lot of you are working in primary care settings. How many of you are working in primary care settings outside of a federal system, so outside of like the DOD or the VA? Wow. Okay, so that's a lot of you. And you guys have money to come to the conference. That's good. So you guys have figured this piece out somehow. This has really been the idea of the idea of healthcare financing and the idea of integration of behavioral health within the context of the integration of behavioral health professionals within primary care settings really has been a challenge for folks practicing within primary care outside of kind of either closed systems like Kaiser or outside of federal systems like the DoD or the VA. This module was led by Ben and Kaylee, and really, if any of you know Ben Miller, he is quite well known for kind of his advocacy and his work related to policy as well as to finance within kind of the integration of behavioral health providers into primary care. And so they did a really nice job of kind of creating a module that provides an overview of healthcare financing and explores how kind of these models that exist and have existed play into interprofessional competencies that provide to quality care. I know for one, when I was in graduate school, we never talked at any great length about financing or how folks get paid for medical care, for behavioral health care, particularly within the medical system and the ways in which that system was set up. And living in this town these days, it's still not clear, what the healthcare financing system's going to be from one week to the next. And so this is very much a moving target. And any time, I know in the past where I was involved in talking about kind of integrated primary care, this was the most common question that folks would ask is about the financing piece. And so it really, this module again provides just such a rich opportunity for folks to sit down, to begin to have some conversations, and to be able to gain some knowledge really about healthcare financing and payment fragmentation that really is kind of changing kind of over time. So, the idea of kind of fee for service, as well as, now there's more of a move towards pay for performance models and having a conversation about that, the role of payment and reimbursement in interprofessional interprofessional care delivery, again, kind of being really important points that the module goes through, talks about, gives some resources. There are some videos here as well as some journal articles, and again these are only a fragment of the resources that are provided within the module. But just the idea of having a crash course in the economics of healthcare probably something that we didn't have going through graduate school for those who went through many years ago, and even in our curriculum today. I mean, I'm in a DoD system, so you get paid thanks to your tax dollars. For other folks who are in the community, this is a critical conversation, and it's critical that not just psychologists understand this, but that all professionals. I mean, to what extent do other professionals really think about the ways in which behavioral health is reimbursed, and how is mental health care within the context of primary care settings kind of reimbursed? And again, this continues to be a moving target as healthcare laws change, and depending on your state, depending on the system where you're in, this is really a module where I would encourage you, really take a look at what some of the points are, but really kind of look then at your your own systems within your own state, within your own communities, within your own systems, and figure out for yourselves, you know, what are some of the ways in which there are similarities and differences in the way that each of the professionals that might be in that room during this course or this class, you know, are getting paid, you know, so that they are able to come to conventions and learn things, you know, being able to support their families. Because at the end of the day, you know, the ideas of integrated care are not going to work unless folks are being reimbursed for the care that's being provided there. So, you know, so again, this is, again, a starting place. There's some great videos, some great readings to give some context to a very complicated topic that really, I think, you know, at this level, it's hard to individualize for your for where you're at. But, you know, this gives you a great starting place for you to begin to adapt it to your own community and to your own places where you're providing care. So that's all for me. I'll pass it over to Ron, and thank you all.
Good morning again. How many of you have watched TV in the last month? How many of you have been frightened about healthcare policy issues or concerned? Talked about it at the water cooler. Woke up from a bad dream. How many have political advocacy and health policy as part of your training? How many do anything about those issues in your current setting? How many of you want to influence the future? So, when I started doing policy workshops and talks, let's say about 10, 12 years ago, or mentioned to colleagues at conventions, I'm available if you want to bring me to Hawaii to give a talk on policy. They looked at their feet. It was usually not something that people really thought about. And then all of a sudden, the idea of health policy and advocacy slowly worked into our field as an expected competency. So we decided that it would be important to have an interprofessional advocacy module so that we could begin to teach learners from all the disciplines to work together, not just in the hospital or the clinic, but in their congressperson's office. So what we did is we defined, we wanted a module that looked at health policy and advocacy both for individuals and for team-based competencies. And we wanted learners to be prepared to demonstrate knowledge of social, political, economic, and cultural factors and policies that impact individuals and the whole system. And the idea is, if you know how to do it, you can actually impact it. Or the old statement, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. So we wanted people in our seminar to learn to be part of the solution and to go forward. And then we defined advocacy more broadly than just pickets on the street corner or going to the congressperson's office, but also thinking about patients' rights locally, equity in healthcare services, and quality care. So there's advocacy is a little broader. So this module was designed around four learning outcomes that focus on health policy and the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. Footnote to that, everybody talks about it as Affordable Care Act. Remember, it's the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. And when you go talk to your congressperson about it, we heard about financing, but what about, and we heard about quality and assurance. We need to make sure that they're brought together and they live together. So it's policy and the Affordable Care Act, values of advocacy, knowledge and competence, components of successful advocacy, and then putting skills, advocacy skills, into successful practice, how to do it. And we focused on looking at current healthcare policies, knowledge and skills, political activities, for example, what is the First Amendment? What are your rights? How do you exercise your First Amendment rights to petition Congress with your grievances, as it says? Talking to students about how do you prepare an op-ed. Imagine a team of medical students, psychology students, OT, PT, nursing, working together on op-ed about why Congress should fund and pay for the costs of interprofessional care, writing that and sending it to the newspaper, or preparing a bunch of talking points and then going to their congressperson or senator's office locally and saying, hello, we're from so-and-so, and we are from these interprofessional disciplines, and we'd like to talk to you about what's going on the Hill right now, and actually giving them the opportunity to role play in the class and then go do it is really what this module is about. And there's some resources, and these are sort of just the key resources. There's others listed in the module, but under what the heck is health policy in the Affordable Care Act, the T.R. Reid video, he's a reporter who's written about healthcare systems, and his talk compares the various systems of healthcare in the United States to the healthcare systems around the world. And it's really entertaining, it's fascinating, and it talks about, for example, if you're getting your care in the VA system, it's not unlike the system in the United Kingdom in terms of access and how the system works, versus your getting your care in Appalachia might be something similar to an unfunded program in Nigeria. I mean, he's really gives some very strong evidence and discussion. The good old-fashioned, I'm just a bill. If you start out with that old cartoon that we all loved, Bill brings students right into thinking about how the heck things get passed on the Hill or don't get passed. And then Gruber has a really interesting cartoon. He was the economist from MIT who worked with both Romney Care and Obamacare, and he was their consultant, and it's a very nice explanation of how that system works. And then you can see the other APA has some very nice online CE courses on the value of advocacy, the knowledge and components of how to be a successful advocate. And then APA also has the Psychologist's Guide to Federal Advocacy, which is a very nice training manual that you can use and integrate into this module within your seminar so that you can teach your learners to speak in a constructive way to power and change the system locally as well as nationally. And I am still available to come to Hawaii to give a lecture on advocacy.
Hello and good morning, everybody. Let's see, I've been tasked with the job of talking about what the naysayers are going to say about adding a seminar, interprofessional seminar, to our existing clinical psychology doctoral training, and some of the strategies that might be employed to counter those concerns and to adjust to those concerns. How many people in here are in faculty in doctoral training and thinking about, okay, we got one, that's two, okay, so three, okay. So a lot, it's an audience that surprised me. I know maybe some of my colleagues as well, that you guys are in primary care, you're thinking about this from that angle. And we, of course, this is a seminar that we put together for hopefully to be adopted by doctoral training programs to get in the game of interprofessional training. A little background on myself. I started in academic medicine, and the first portion of my career, and now my second act is in doctoral training. So I've kind of straddled both worlds of academic medicine and doctoral training. So that helped me being involved in this kind of work that brings together in our literally the two campuses in quite a few training programs. You've got your health sciences campus and your humanities campus, where the not uncommonly the clinical psychology doctoral program, counseling program, is located. I know we have some exceptions here, and some of you probably went to programs that are based in medical programs, on health science campuses, and good for you if you did, and it might be why you're in primary care. Advancing my slide, so I have that background, and I started in geropsychology and rehab psychology, two specialty areas in psychology that we're talking about. Team work and team care and multidisciplinary care way back when I was in my training. So it was natural progression for me to move into primary care and bring my students in that arena at VCU, where we have a very robust program and funded by GPE for training doctoral, clinical, and counseling students in primary care. Does anybody else work with GPE trainees? We've got one. Okay. That's a great program that APA has advocated for and has really transformed how we do business and at VCU, which is, so I'm very grateful for advocacy. Speaking about Ron's comments about the importance of advocacy, those funds came about with a lot of cajoling and advocacy work to help our training programs, some of them around the country, a growing number, thankfully, start these kind of programs. So what are some of the challenges in implementing a interprofessional seminar that's going to put psychologists in this kind of teaching setting? You've got to find partners, is the starting point, because you're not going to design one of these programs within your program if you're a clinical psychology training program, doctoral program, and then look for partners. You start with the partners who have the same vision and goal, and frequently that's an easier task than some of the other challenges, because throughout the country now, interprofessional training is at the forefront of healthcare training. It's become a really hot issue that leadership in medical training world has really embraced, and they want to get on the bandwagon and so forth. So you can find partners at, for instance, at VCU, we already had an interprofessional education institute. So pretty easy place to find partners if you're lucky enough to have that. You've got all the disciplines in healthcare. We've got them listed here that have an interest in interprofessional education. Those are some of your partners. You probably need three at a minimum to really call yourself an interprofessional training program. So you got to find two partners, most likely. More the merrier if you can get some other programs. But the complexities of setting up a seminar start multiplying as you add each discipline, as you know, because each one has their own. This is one of the Tower of Babel. Sometimes I think of it as the training schedule for each specific health discipline at a health sciences university There's been some efforts nationwide to try to, within a health science university, to coordinate schedules so we can do more interprofessional training together and have our classes coincide where our practicum, what we call practicum, their clinical assignments and so forth, and the length of those assignments and the semester itself is, you know, to try to coordinate across the schools so that they we can do more of these shared classes. So finding the partners, the one of the discussions we had in our group was I've had more success partnering with in medicine with residents. ACGME has a lot of requirements for adding team training and behavioral science training to the residency, and they have little dedicated slots, and they're all the people that want run the residencies are typically more clinical than they are academic, and so they're looking for partners to help them fill some of those slots, and that's where we've had some of our luck. Same thing in my case with pharmacy residency program. They have requirements from their accrediting agency to add some seminar content to meet their, check their boxes for their accreditation. So those are good places to look. And then finding champions who are going to work with you on the doctoral training side. You've got to find some champions to help build the case with your colleagues frequently that this is a worthy piece to add to clinical training. And so you've got to find some funding, some course release time, and so forth. So you got to get some buy-in from your dean or your provost, from your department chair, funding for bringing teams together, course buyouts for the, this is complicated because you don't have one course instructor for this. You're hopefully going to have faculty representation from each of the disciplines in your seminar, so you've got to find somebody on the health sciences campus that believes strongly in this goal and gives faculty release time. Let's see. I mentioned the schedule problem already and the challenge of the schedule. Is sometimes that the most practical thing to do is work with the shortest schedule among your disciplines. For instance, our nursing program has 8-week, one-credit modules that they have in their curriculum, so we that would be a good place to start if I was going to partner with nursing to create one of these seminars and do it as a 8-week program. How do you deal with your colleagues and all of our health science friends who raised the point that, well, we've got so much curriculum already. We've packed the schedule. We don't have any extra credit hours in the semester, perhaps, to build this in. I don't know about the programs that you all went to, we're continually trying to find ways to jettison credits and reduce our coursework so our students can spend more time on research and clinical activities, hands-on learning, and less time in the classroom. So whenever you get your grumblers when you say, hey, let's add another 2-credit class. And so 1 credit is good way to think about it. Affiliating the seminar with an existing course, have it be a lab. Workload, of course, is a concern. Having the setting up the seminar so that everybody does just a little bit of reading or watches a video, something they can do relatively easily and come to the classroom, and the learning and work takes place in the classroom is a good way to sell it. What are some of the incentives that you can give to faculty and trainees to get involved in interprofessional training? We have a voluntary course on our health sciences campus that our psychologists have yet to take because of some of the aforementioned concerns. Plus, I get a lot of interprofessional training already through the stuff we do in primary care. But they have a voluntary course, and that's not a bad option as a starting place to get your highly committed students who really want to get in on this stuff and pick it as an elective. But for faculty, you get your course buyouts, collecting data for publishing outcomes in peer-reviewed outlets. You've seen a few citations for MedEd Portal. One of the anybody in here publish anything in MedEd Portal? It's a very convenient and easy outlet for peer review work where you design class materials, and what you're submitting largely is your class materials that you put together, and then you have some text about how you created it, what some of the outcomes were. It's a nice opportunity to share your work, and if you go there, there's an amazing amount of content for health science training. You can apply for grants internally and externally, of course. The award recognition should not be overlooked. Our Interprofessional Education Institute has a terrific award program that recognizes and students who were exemplary in interprofessional care and did well in their classes and went to settings and stood out as excellent team contributors. It's a nice, easy, free way to incentivize and recognize students. We have the similar awards for faculty that do that work very well, awarded on an annual basis. Lastly, the picking your structure. We've touched on that a little bit as we've marched through the different topics. We're talking, we want to get teams interacting. We don't want the talking head in front of the classroom. So the learning being interactive is critical. Having it simulate a team by breaking into, if it's a large seminar, you got to put everybody, break into smaller groups, something around a team size of nine. Maybe nine is a number that works for us in our seminar that we do. The team-based learning approaches are very good, where you has anybody worked with TBL training? It's a hot area in healthcare training right now. So you're breaking up into teams, and they have a structure where they have a task, a challenge to create a solution to each team, and you have the teams work on their solution. And then you call on each team. You stop after they've come up with their solution, call on each team, and the team has a representative, a leadership person, to give their answer and present their case for why they would do their, say, a treatment plan they would be coming up with. Very nice model that I recommend looking into. So lots of creative things out there that we've packed into our downloadable seminar that how you can do group exercises to keep it very active, the learning process, because we don't, our trainees are already grumbling about too many hours spent in the classroom as a passive listener. So that's kind of the extent of what I had, and I'll turn it over to Susan.
Okay, so I think you have a sense now of what is offered in this curriculum, and it is really a rich offering. I just want to make a comment that I think our audience illustrates what some of the challenges are with regard to moving, I think psychology has a history of being pretty good at exposing our trainees to interprofessional training at, once it's applied, you know, whether it's in the clinic or on the research team. We're pretty good at that. But it's in the educational years, the foundational stuff is really very psychology-centric, I think. And it's that that process that, as I started thinking about the this initiative, that I really wanted to have some impact on. But there's a problem. If everyone in the doctoral programs or at the teaching in the at the education level have not done the work themselves, then how is that going to happen? And I would suggest that those of you sitting here can offer in the graduate programs that you're maybe associated with or that are across the campus to do this for them. Because I think it is much less likely if people haven't had the experience themselves that they're going to bring it early in the doctoral training when I think it's so important. And it requires, obviously, articulating a rationale that's compelling because it's always, well, accreditation this and, you know, overload that and et cetera. But when you put the importance of really understanding what it is to be part of a team, what it is to work interprofessionally, and how important that particular value needs to happen early on, to me, those arguments are much weaker than the argument that we really need to get in there early, if only to influence the other disciplines. But of course, my own view is we need to influence ourselves as well. The other argument that is frequent is, you know, with Erickson, you need identity before you need intimacy, you know, that you need a strong professional identity before you can throw people out into the big bad world of interprofessional work. I just don't buy that. I think that it's an excellent opportunity in an interprofessional seminar for students to have to define themselves to each other. It's a process that facilitates identity development and understanding what each other is good for. My experience in training interns and postdocs, when they come into the primary care setting, we put them early on into a seminar with the family medicine residents who are learning about family systems and how to work with the families of their patients and how to do good more than one person interviewing. And they're always, almost always, quite surprised at how much these residents know about their area, the psychosocial area. And, you know, I wish that it wasn't true that they waited that long before they found out that actually medical school has quite a bit of training in psychosocial issues. It varies, but a lot of them do now. And so that, you know, and I would like the family medicine people to already know psychology students, not just the occasional psychologist who taught them in medical school. And I would like our psychology students for it not to be a novelty to be taught by a physician or a nurse or a pharmacist, you know, early in their training around basic information. So I think we still have a long way to go, and it's going to require people who are used to teaching at a more advanced clinical level to be willing to offer and negotiate to do some of these early seminars for it to change, I think. But we have kept on schedule because this is such a really disciplined group. And we have a good 25 minutes to hear what your ideas and questions and comments are. I will repeat your question because it is being videotaped. And then whoever is answering, if you can use the mic, that should work out well. So please. Yes. Berwick. So the question is, how much emphasis is put on having the patient, and I would add family, as part of the team, and referring to some of Don Berwick's, has some very compelling writings, especially about when his wife was ill, and the nothing about me without me phrase. So who would like to take that one?
Yes.
Would you like to elaborate, Ron?
Is it not on? Is it on?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think the one thought I had about that is almost all of us have been consumers of healthcare and have had family members and personal experiences navigating the healthcare system. And I think, while yes, I do think there's an absolute opportunity to be able to integrate kind of patient experience with actual patients, but there is kind of the spectrum in which that could happen, really by having a group of interprofessional learners who are there who can talk about their own experiences in healthcare, the barriers that they've seen. I think there's a good amount of opportunity, and bringing in that patient experience, that patient and family-centered care, I think does cut across kind of the concepts in the module in terms of population health and quality improvement and the works.
That's a great point you made, by the way. It's terrific that something that didn't come up in our discussion. In rehab medicine, there's always been a push to include patients in patient staffing meetings, and that's always been a challenge of how do you make that work and the practicalities of it. But that's great that you brought that up.
I think because this was conceived of as a seminar early in graduate training, a lot of it is conceptual with exercises, and certainly patients and family-centered care is a core part of that. You can imagine bringing in patients and interviewing them around some of these different issues, whether it's healthcare financing or whatever. But I think the emphasis probably is more on the relationship among the students themselves as they think about including the patient and family. But it does cut across. For example, reimbursement for patient satisfaction scores naturally would be part of the healthcare financing piece.
Just to build on a little bit what Susan was just saying, one thing we didn't talk a whole lot about this morning were those competencies that I mentioned in my remarks, the interprofessional education collaborative competencies, and central to that framework is the whole idea of patient-centered care, and the patient is part of the team. So conceptually, a lot of what we've designed in this curriculum really speaks to delivery of care with the patient and family involved.
When you do download the 200 pages, you'll find lots of references to patient-centered care. At the University of Florida, we have a course similar to this, not as good as the one we've shown you, but it's quite good, and it's called Family. It's a family health course. It's for first-year students across the Health Science Center who, from medicine, dentistry, pharmacy, psychology, PT, OT, and they actually work with a family. So each of the teams of students are assigned a family who volunteers to be part of the course, and then they do a health assessment of the core of the family from each perspective. One of the nice things I've heard from some of our students is a lot of things dealing with these families tend to be behavioral health, psychological issues, so our students get an opportunity to see that they've got something to add as part of their first year in graduate school. Speaking to Susan's point of identity, they get a
quick jolt of identity as leaders in a interprofessional team. But we do have lots of resources.
And yes. I think, you know, so much of this curriculum is intended to be adapted to what resources you have, you know, within your teaching environment. And, you know, the idea is that this is a starting place for a lot of this, and I think the ideas of patient-centered care are a big piece of everything that we talk about. But you can certainly imagine, so for instance, medical students at our school go and visit a family with special needs. They have a special needs child, and just the, you know, the challenges associated with navigating kind of the health system, under those circumstances. And, you know, I think associated with this curriculum, although it's not explicitly part of this, you know, one of the ways that I might adapt it is I would take, you know, send our psychology students, you know, with kind of the medical students and have them kind of, interviewing and working with those families together. So, you know, so you can imagine, you know, but that would be very unique to my system, you know, and kind of where I'm at and where my students are. And, you know, so much of this is about kind of, you know, crossing the campus, you know, the idea of, you know, if you're in an arts and sciences, you know, kind of situation with your psychology program, getting to the medical center and finding, you know, how medical students are being trained or other professionals are being trained and finding those relationships. But that would be totally consistent with, I think, the themes that we're trying to push throughout the curriculum. So thank you for that question.
I think most medical schools have that thing where students follow a family, and it's a great idea to, you know, send our psychology students along with them through a few years. Yes. Okay, so the question is, how could this curriculum be adapted at different stages of training, from early in doctoral training to internship to postdoc, and maybe actually beyond that?
I think one of the things that we were very mindful of when we created this curriculum was our learning experiences that we recommended that people use in each of the modules, and we had to be very careful of the types of clinical scenarios that we presented to the learners and make sure that they were not more advanced than they'd had opportunity to have exposure to in their other classroom experiences. So I think that would be the way that this would differ with learners that are further along in the education and training pipeline, where the clinical complexity of the cases that illustrate some of these core foundations could be at a very different level.
So I think on the quality improvement side of things, I think one of the ways to kind of bridge the curriculum for more advanced learners would be to add actual projects within teams, because you're in a clinical environment. So thinking about the module is designed for a classroom kind of conversation about quality, but once you're ultimately in a more advanced clinical setting, there's really the opportunity to apply it and kind of go beyond some of the tools that are there and go to the more advanced tools that you can actually implement. So that would be, I think, within that module, one way to kind of bridge that to more advanced learners.
I just wanted to say, I think quality improvement is an obvious place where we can make a big contribution, and it'll be much easier to do that if the students have learned about it ahead of time. It's a pretty easy translation from our scientific training. But if we've already done that earlier, and interns or postdocs can come right in and help facilitate the quality improvement projects that the residents all have to do, at least where I am, in an ongoing way, it immediately gives the psychologist or the psychology trainee a role that they feel comfortable with and with a level of expertise that the other trainees typically don't have.
I worked on the population health module, and there's some great ideas out there about trainees formulating a population health initiative in their clinical setting and implementing it as a project. I think it was a great thing that I learned that I'm going to consider down the road.
You know, and Mark, thanks for your question, because, you know, I think so many of these activities, I think, can be applied at different stages of training, and I think the depth and the type of conversation, you know, that students would end up having or learners would end up having is probably going to be the thing that's going to differ the most, you know, as you go through. It's, you know, it's hard to think about any of these modules as being something that would be unique to, you know, graduate students, you know, to interns or residents or to fellows even. You know, I think that all of these things, depending on where somebody is, again, this serves as a starting place, and, you know, I think that while there is education kind of within here, you know, for me, I think a lot of the education piece is going to come through those conversations. And I think regardless of where you are in training, it's going to be valuable to have those conversations. And, you know, but we did have in mind, you know, the idea of, you know, we want to start these conversations earlier and not just when folks are kind of getting into their clinical settings.
From my first set of slides, when I introduced the structure of the seminar, we said non-prescriptive, and we purposely didn't provide structured lecture materials or PowerPoints, but really designed it to give you resources and an outline of content per module, as you've heard, which gives you then an opportunity to back into your level, your issues locally, and the level of the students within the class. So I think there's flexibility in that we've given you lots of stuff you can use to tinker it and make it local.
And I'll say that the group we brought together by definition have a lot of expertise in this area, but I think we had very lively discussions on all these topics and learned a lot from each other. So that was definitely true. I think it can happen at all levels. I think my own concern, as was just said, is that it happens late in the game, and I would like it to be part of our training from the beginning so that we're always identifying that way. Yes. So the question was, coming from an early career psychologist who just came out of a program that was very clinical science oriented, that there wasn't any advocacy payment models, any of those issues in her program, nor there was there in mine, but I went to school way before you. And so how do you make the argument, if everything's organized around what's going to help you as a researcher, how do you make an argument to a program like that, that this interprofessional learning is very important? And I guess I could start with one answer and then turn it over to my colleagues, which is team science is definitely what NIH wants to see and many funders want to see. And this set of modules, this seminar is the basis and provides people with the skills to really do good team science. But other thoughts?
So what I would say to a faculty like you just described was, where'd your grant money come from? And they'll say, from NIH, because we do good science. And I would say, really? where'd the NIH money come from? And they'd say, from Congress, because we do good research. And then I would say, really? And then I would just very politely explain how advocacy works, and that we don't just get money for our research because we do good work. We get money for our research because we do good work, and we know how to explain that to our congressperson and localize it and say the dollars we get for Alzheimer's research is because someone has gone to the Hill, explained Alzheimer's, and localized it to grandma. And so it really is helping folks that are very much in that world understand that the funding for their educational program, their funding for the research, and the fact that there's a clinic out there where the students can go get trained, there's dollars coming in. So it really is helping the faculty understand the reality of where dollars come from for research, for clinical, and for classroom teaching.
It's also an opportunity to speak about the importance of APA, because often APA is the has the expertise to pull in people like Ron and many of us who've done advocacy on the Hill. It's through the association that has the relationships with people on the Hill that can really train and focus the advocacy so that we get as much research dollars as possible in the areas of interest that we think are important, as much education money as we can, as possible, to train people. So, other ideas.
Yeah, I think it's a great question, and I think to take Ron's discussion a little bit further, to think about where's that money ultimately coming from is, from the taxpayer and from the people who ultimately need to be able to benefit from that research and from the clinical care. I think as Susan had mentioned too, that research anymore, is going to involve multiple professionals. And all of these issues, when you're doing kind of clinical science, are going to come up regardless of whether you're directly provide in a clinical role, or you're conducting clinical science with individuals as part of that team, and so these issues are important there. But sometimes there's probably probably been some good talks on motivational interviewing at APA, so you might use some motivational interviewing skills on that faculty member. Are they contemplative? The other piece is, if they're not willing to do it, I think there are things in here where you as a student, can take it and run with it and create your own groups, create your own learning experiences, finding other interested professionals, other, who are enrolled in programs within your university, and say, hey, we've got this curriculum. This is a starting place. When you look at the stuff, you don't need somebody, sitting on high kind of directing all of this. You as a graduate student could take this and say, I'd like to form a group of interprofessionals and talk about some of these issues and how it applies to doing research. So thinking about, if you don't have folks within the faculty who are willing to do it, taking upon yourselves to make it happen, I think is another way to go.
Those are both great ideas. Use the advocacy model to develop a plan to advocate for this with your faculty and recognize that you hear no once, that doesn't, that you're just working on the way to yes, and it can take doing that a lot of times, like it does with congresspeople. Nancy.
Take more than one card. Take three, take four, take five. Hand them to your friends.
How about somebody who has been on the accreditation committee? Nancy. So Dr. Ruddy gave a plug for the wonderful curriculum that Dr. Vogel, Dr. Ward Zimmerman, Dr. Ruddy, many talented people put together. And it's very, it's both slick and substantial, and does give you all the very specific slides and guides and you name it, so that faculty can, who have not done this work but know it's important. So I think Nancy's question was, how do we really bring this down to the doctoral level when the incentives really aren't there? They may be there in, for example, health psychology, clinical health psychology programs, but what about clinical and counseling, even school psychology programs? And I actually think that that interns, postdocs, and early career psychologists have play a big role here, because I think it's when they go back and say, you know, we really needed to learn this earlier. I really want a practicum. You know, once you have a practicum experience in primary care, then you can move from that into, well, we really could have used an interprofessional seminar, and APA has one, resources. You know, can we get a perhaps new faculty person who isn't too focused down on a particular area to support that? But I do think it's going to take something like that. Comments?
As somebody who has just survived their accreditation visit, barely. Now, you know, we were doing a lot in terms of preparation, and actually, even though we weren't under the standards of accreditation, the new standards of accreditation, that we were kind of getting the program to fall under kind of the new standards of accreditation. You know, I think that when you start to look at what some of the competencies are that are being asked of psychologists right now to be formed, and you see that there are things related to interprofessional training, there are things related to advocacy, there you know, are topics related to leadership, you know. And so, you know, for me, as I was looking at that, you know, I mean, I actually felt like in order to make sure I was checking all those boxes, we actually created a class that was, you know, that was before we kind of had this this interprofessional seminar developed. But I felt like if I'm going to be sure that my students are kind of getting all these things, I have to create a more structured framework to make sure it happens. Now I get to steal from the interprofessional workshop and take some of the materials in there. But I think that APA has actually put some of those contingencies into place now that are going to start to shape programs moving forward, and that we're going to have to do it if we're going to continue to be accredited. So there is some of that there, and Kathy can probably talk a lot more about that piece of it. But I certainly felt as a training director of a clinical psychology program that I had to have some of this material in there.
I know we're running really short
on
time.
Yes.
But just 2 cents on that one. Certainly to reiterate Susan's point that students are really an important change agent in this process, but I think it's also incumbent on all of you that are working in these settings to become aware of these resources and to share them with your colleagues, because we want people to be well trained before they venture into these settings. And so the burden's on us to say this is not something you just walk into casually. You need to be trained.
I'll make one more comment and then we need to stop, which is I some time ago hired a faculty person who actually had a postdoc, then he became faculty, Tony Pisani. But when he was on internship, he wanted a primary care placement as part of it, and there wasn't any. So he talked his supervisors into letting him create one. So he went out and got a pediatrician to agree that he could go out in the office, and then he set up modules and readings for his supervisor to read in primary care, so his supervisor would be able to supervise him. I'm not sure that was the direction it went, but anyway, and then he wrote an article about it, so it's in the literature about how students can set up what it is they need. So I do think the push from underneath, and also responsible training directors like Dr. Goodie, who know where the jobs are out there. So there's both student interest and there's opportunity after that, make it all very important. But thanks so much for coming and for your participation and for your own work in this area.